Nation in the 21st century. I'm your host, Carl Ball, founder and director of the Creation Evidence Museum in Glen Rose, Texas. Today's program is titled, Planet Earth is Special. And it is very, very special, uniquely special. In fact, the Word of God begins like this. In the beginning, God created the heaven, that is the space-time dimension, the Shemayim. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. During that first day of creation, God initially, momentarily, quickly created the space-time dimension, and the very first object that he created in that space-time dimension was planet Earth. It was embryonic. It was not until day number two that God placed a firmament above it. It was not until day number three, and those were literal solar days. It was not until day number three that God clothed it with terra firma, made the dry land, the internal portion of the earth, and then created the first living systems outside himself, the plants. And then, on day number four, he created the stellar bodies, the stars, the sun, the moon, the planets, the galaxies. On day number five, the fish and the fowl. Day number six, he created the great land reptiles, the mammals, man, and then woman. God did it right. And it's obvious that progressively during the week of creation, during the 6 days of creation week, the full week of creation, God had a plan and a purpose, building a foundation, and ultimately on day number six, crowned it with that which was made in his image. Planet Earth is special. And I've invited a very special friend to talk about this with us today, Professor John Heffner. Professor, it is always a pleasure to have you with us on the program.
Thank you. It's good to be here with you.
You are, as you know, my favorite replacement when I'm gone at the museum. In fact, you could handle it with or without me, not as a replacement. You stand on your own. And you've done a tremendous job over the years as a guest on the program today. Now, you have spent, as you know, almost four decades as a career mathematician. And you, for 25 years now, have been in the Kilgore, in fact, more than 25 years, in the Kilgore Public School System. You're head of the math department. You teach pre-calculus and algebra and trigonometry and all of those very nice, intriguing mathematical disciplines.
Yes.
And then you teach at Kilgore College as an adjunct professor.
Yes.
As well. But you know all of those things.
Yeah.
I just want the audience to know that this guest is uniquely qualified to discuss what we're going to talk about. Professor, when you were in high school, you, as did I, you fought atheistic thoughts. Is that correct?
Yes, I entertained them. I certainly did, and had pretty well decided I was one.
But what changed you?
Well, the Lord did. He has
the
a way
Lord
of
did.
Getting your attention.
Yes.
And opening your eyes to the truth.
And since you're a mathematician, a career mathematician, and a scientist, an investigative scientist in your own right, what part did the actual, literal logistics and the truth play? Demonstrable truth, mathematical persuasion.
Well, it had a very large role, especially subsequent to my conversion experience.
Yes.
To solidify me in the faith and to give me a passion for aiding the other skeptics that are out there like I was.
And I'm sure watching this program at this moment, our skeptics, in fact, we invite the skeptics. Mm-hmm. And now, you have designed a program. In fact, I believe you recently attended a special conference on
Yes.
the uniqueness of planet Earth.
Mm-hmm.
So, would you share some of those Sure. tremendous insights with
Love
us?
To. Love to. Well, it started when I saw an article recently in the newspaper about the discovery of a new planet, meet planet Earth's newest neighbor.
Mm.
And I began mulling this over, and of course I put this together. Well, Mabel, there goes the neighborhood.
Yes.
But this is, it's interesting to me that planet Earth is always the standard by which everything is measured, and rightly so. But this thing is supposedly 120 trillion miles away, this new planet. European astronomers have been credited with finding it, although U.S. astronomers competed in the hunt. And it's similar in some ways, but different in other ways. It's a larger body than the Earth. The sun is a faint glow, like a charcoal ember, the article went on to say. And you could have a birthday party there every 13 days. So the orbital speed is quite a bit faster to go around the its sun so rapidly. But you would also weigh 1.6 times as much on the planet. So as they said, you'd have to be careful with the birthday cake.
Yes. Now, what I'm gathering from what you're saying is that this newly discovered planet would not be hospitable for us or for life as we know it at all. Is that correct?
Well, the jury's still out on that. At least that's what the astronomers are saying. I would be surprised if there's any place that's hospitable for life other than this one.
Well, now, let's reiterate that statement again. That is a profound statement. Mm-hmm. In fact, in my library, I have a book called The Rare Earth, mm-hmm. written totally from the secular viewpoint, without mm-hmm. any creationistic or biblical or religious overtones mm-hmm. whatsoever. And since we've had the SETI program and we've had so many additional programs mm-hmm. committed to finding another place where life could exist, yeah. and according to evolutionary theory, where life could have evolved mm-hmm. simultaneous with planet Earth, even though life did not evolve on planet Earth. But they're having to admit, even though they're still desperately seeking for an out as to evolutionary development mm-hmm. somewhere else, they have or now had to admit in a scientific dimension that planet Earth is rare, it is unique, it's the only place we've ever found where life could exist.
Well, exactly. And of course, the search for complex carbon-based life is essentially the search for where water could exist in liquid form. Because yes. that narrow temperature range where water is liquid is also the temperature range where carbon-based life is, where carbon is most active, carbon chemistry is most active.
Yes.
So that narrows the search down quite a bit. And of course, the claim is that this planet has you know, temperatures that are comparable to Earth. Like I say, the jury's still out. Something that's 120 trillion miles away, it's going to take a while to investigate. But I think it's interesting that it's compared to Earth, and that is the standard. And is life on Earth really all that special? You know, the evolutionists have said for years, well, no, it's really not. In fact, we're one among many, probably. But you know what? You put the list of the ones they found where complex life is possible, and so far there's none. There is a candidate, but I'd be surprised if we find something there.
Absolutely. And so far we have found nothing outside planet Earth. So we will go with the facts rather than speculation.
Exactly. And of course the cover of popular magazines are constantly comparing creation and evolution and showcasing evolution, to be honest about it. Evolution Wars, the push to teach intelligent design raises a question. Does God have a place in science class? You know, something that challenges the established paradigm of evolution is usually met with great contempt. You know, it's almost a crime to even question evolution. And so when a recent intelligent design conference was scheduled for the Dallas area on the campus of SMU, I was very interested, especially since my interest was piqued recently with the discovery of Gliese 581c, this candidate, an Earth-like planet.
Yes.
And I was very interested in the fact that the article came out that said the professors were angry about the upcoming conference. And I thought the university campuses were supposed to be a bastion of free thought and acceptance and tolerance.
So did I. And in fact, I've lectured on that campus mm-hmm. on scientific creation. Yet, they are more adamant now than they were a few years ago when I lectured and probably would not be permitted to lecture on campus.
Right, and a number of the school's departments were listed as having submitted letters, I guess, to the president to ban the conference. That sounds just exactly like censorship to me.
Absolutely.
But fortunately, he did not ban it, and the conference took place.